So welcome to this reprise presentation of an ASMS oral, which I gave 2 weeks ago at ASMS in St. Louis. My name is Russell Mortishire-Smith. I'm a senior consultant scientist with Waters Corporation. I've been with Waters for 2 years now. And before that, I worked for Johnson & Johnson and Merck Sharp & Dohme doing DMPK experiments and analytical sciences. So the talk today is going to cover some new product introductions that Waters have for doing drug screening and drug characterization, drug metabolism characterization, using a combination of novel hardware and novel software. So I'll cover five things in this presentation. So the first point is when we do in a DMPK environment any study, we're making an investment. We're making the choice to invest time and money in an outcome. And we want that outcome to be as impactful as we can to maximize the return on investment. So I want to talk today about ways in which we can leverage the experiments we do to make them impactful. And we're going to do that through a variety of ways. The first thing we're going to do is talk about how ion mobility-enabled experiments can add significant value to the experiments that we do. Second thing is I'm going to talk about some new features in software for addressing the challenge of the large data sets that we're creating and how we can reduce noise and make the data analysis as streamlined as possible. Next thing we're going to talk about is integrated data analysis and how we can use CCS to our advantage in a whole variety of ways to improve the outcomes of the studies that we do. And finally, I'm going to talk about what NMR spectroscopists have talked about for a long while, and that's using more than one dimension to look at the data that we create and how we can use multiple dimensions to understand that data. So here are four common challenges that a DMPK scientist has. So the first one is complex biological backgrounds. And the challenge there is that we're looking for a whole variety of drug-related material, might be conjugates or simple oxidations or breakdown products, in a forest of peaks, which can come from whether it's bile or urine or matrix background or formulation and so on. So we have the challenge of how do we find the signal in the noise? How do we find the needle in the haystack? Second challenge that we might face is retention time shifting. So we might start off with one simple method, a ballistic gradient, but over time that method evolves and the analytes of interest that we're looking at move around in the chromatogram depending on what gradient we use, what column we use, what excipients we have in there and so on. And we want to track the analytes of interest across those different chromatograms. The third challenge that we have is characterizing the site of metabolism. Telling a chemist that they have a simple hydroxylation isn't of any use if they want to reduce clearance. We need to provide a point-specific, an atom-specific, or a group-specific localization that allows them to make that point change, which is going to reduce clearance. Or if we have a pharmacodynamic effect, to understand the nature of the metabolite, the specific metabolite that we have that's modulating the efficacy over time. And then the third challenge is, especially if we're using generic methods like MSC or HDMSC, how do we go from a relatively complex spectrum at a retention time into just looking at those signals which are actually target-related or drug-related for the component that's of interest? So the first thing I want to cover is HDMSC. And HDMSC is an evolution of an old method, 10 or more years now, MSC. And the value that I want to talk about today is the added value that having ion mobility has to improve the quality and the way in which we can approach that data. So HDMSC works like this. We have metabolites separated by chromatography, but suppose that we have two co-eluting metabolites going into the system. They're ionized in the source, but in the middle of the instrument, we have an ion mobility cell. And in that ion mobility cell, we can separate the components based on their drift time, which is a function of their size and shape. And so in the low energy channel, those co-eluting precursors are separated in drift time and are resolvable in individual spectra. In the high energy trace, the chromatography is obviously the same, and the ions come in to the drift time device as they did in the low energy channel. They're separated by their drift time. But now we do a non-specific fragmentation post-drift time, post-ion mobility separation. And what that generates is product ion spectra, which are drift time aligned with their precursor molecules. And that allows us to generate individual product ion spectra for each of those metabolites or co-eluting entities, even though they're actually co-eluting in retention time. So the ability to do these kinds of experiments has been around for a while with the SYNAPT family of products. And in the SYNAPT family of products, the ion mobility separation is in the center of the instrument in the tri-wave, and it's bracketed by two independent collision cells, one before and one after. And what we introduced at ASMS this year was the Vion family. So it's an evolution of the architecture of SYNAPT, but it differs in one particular way. And that's the ion mobility device is now up front. So ion mobility separations occurs before the quadrupole, before the collision cell. And that allows us to do a variety of different things. That architecture enables different quantitation modes, different qualitative analysis modes as well. And on the back end, we have an enhanced flight tube, 50,000 res, the detector on that has improved linear dynamic range over the older generation instruments. So the samples that I'll be talking about today are all representative of the kinds of samples that you would generate inside a modern DMPK laboratory. So intrinsic clearance experiments, and I've used nifazidone as a representative compounds in both hepatocytes and microsomes, a simple protein crash, and then we've acquired the data in HGMSC mode either on SYNAPT or on Vion using a standard ballistic gradient, and we process the data using the latest version of Unify software and some of the visualizations I did externally in Spotfire. So let's just generally talk about HGMSC then as an acquisition platform. So there's good news and bad news. The good news is that HRMS, high-resolution mass spec, really transformed the qualitative analysis world. And very few people now are going back to using tandem quads or ion traps, simple ion traps, to do qualitative analysis. And that's because it's a full scan approach, it's a generic approach, so it requires little optimization per compound, it's information rich, you're limited only really by your imagination and the way you approach analyzing the data. So that's the good news. The bad news is that in the same things which are a blessing when it comes for looking for stuff, looking for compounds of interest, also make those data sets large. So HRMS is a full scan generic, it's data and it's information rich. And as our instruments have got more sensitive and as our resolution on the instruments has increased, the data file sizes have increased concomitantly. So at Waters over the last year or so, we've been looking at ways in which we can ameliorate that problem and address it and make the problem again manageable again. So I'm going to talk about a couple of the approaches that are now embedded in Waters software for addressing this issue. So here's a representative nifazidone incubation in hepatocytes, and I'm showing the data in a three-dimensional way. So on the x-axis, we've got retention time, and on the y-axis, we have master charge. And then coming up out of the page, we have intensity. So you can see inside here, there's a lot of signals, some background noise, some chemical noise. And inside that family of peaks, there are around 25 to 30 real nifazidone metabolites. And those are the ones that we want to hone in on. So how can we address that challenge of noise? We want to maximize the signal that we have, but we want to reduce the noise which is present. So one thing that we can do is called adaptive background subtraction. So on the top in panel A, you can see a raw spectrum. And inside that raw spectrum, there are some consistently varying low-level signals, which are very periodic. And those are characteristic of the chemical noise in the background. And we can create a mathematical model for those. Then we can subtract those periodic signals from the data to give you panel C. So that's the background subtracted spectrum. And of course, that's got a lower amount of noise in it. So that's going to help us. The second thing we can do is called data sweeping, and we can do that either in one, two, or three dimensions. So just looking at this in one dimension now. So here's a peak, and at the base of the peak, you'll see there's some noise. So how could we remove that noise? So a traditional approach might be to threshold. So by thresholding, we are simply going to remove any signals that are below a particular intensity height. And that's a simple method, and it can work for you, but it has a challenge, and that is that the intrinsic peak shape is lost when we do that. So we lose the Gaussian peak shape and by removing all the noise around the base of the peak. So using a data sweep approach, what we do is we retain the signal that's belonging to a peak. When we do the componentization, we identify the peak. And then as we follow the peak down to the baseline, we retain any intensity in the spectrum which is associated with the component. And then beyond that space around the base of the peak, then we can zero things out. And we can do that in one dimension at the spectral level. We can do two-dimensional or three-dimensional componentization. And the goal here is to make sure the peak is fully defined together with a small amount of noise around the base of the peak. And in that hepatocyte incubation, at top right, you can see the raw data, and we have you can see some systematic ridges there in the data with peaks superimposed on top of those. And there are 10 to 12 real signals in that data. And you can see that we've detected those. We've kept a region of noise around the base, but the rest has gone to zero. And that's reduced our file size. Okay, so that's how we can do what we call dynamic noise reduction. What are the impacts on the data that we acquire? So in this first panel here, you can see the impact on file size. And we have the option in the software of doing the equivalent of a raw data acquisition on a modern digital camera, or low, moderate, or high JPEG compression. It's that kind of approach. And you can see if we do a low active noise reduction, low dynamic noise reduction, the file size is reduced by about 80%. Medium, it's about 90%, and high, it's about 95%. So at the top level of dynamic noise reduction, we have about a 20-fold compression reduction in file size. Activities in the software, which take time, such as XIC generation, scale linearly with file size. So you can see on that top right panel that as the files get smaller, XIC generation gets faster. Interestingly, total processing time doesn't scale quite that way, because remember, we're removing noise, we're not removing signal. And so once we've done the componentization, we're hoping that we'll be left with a comparable number of signals which require interpretation. So although we get some improvements in processing time, it's actually not unexpected that we don't get a linear reduction in total processing time. So what about the impact on quantitative outcomes? We want to make sure that when we process quantitative data that we don't get any different results because we've applied these kinds of dynamic noise reductions. So we've looked at these approaches with a range of quantitative data sets using calibration curves and QCs, just looking at the impact on quantitative outcomes. And here's a representative example. So a 7-point calibration curve over an appropriate calibration range. And when we just do the two-dimensional peak finding and quantitation, there's no real impact on peak areas. And actually, in the dynamically noise-reduced data, some of the low calibration standards actually come into specification, whereas previously they were outside. So you can see on calibration 2 there, calibration 0.2 actually comes inside a 20% value, whereas it was out before. So that's the quantitative side. What about the qualitative side? What about finding drug metabolites and so on? So here's a slide taken from a paper that we published in 2005 on what we called at the time all-in-one data analysis, which is now implemented as MSE in Waters software, and all-in-one fragmentation elsewhere. So the flowchart looks something like I previously described. We have a low collision energy channel, which we look at for drug metabolites. We have a high energy channel in which we can find the product ions of the parent. We can do XICs for those. We can generate modified constant neutral losses or constant neutral losses based on the biotransformation changes, and then we can look for those in the components which we detect. And when we find a precursor, we can do time alignment in order to generate a product ion spectrum, and ultimately that delivers us a localized biotransformation. And the point that I want to make on these slides is that many of these steps, these ones that I've highlighted in green, actually are significantly improved when we have ion mobility in the toolkit, in the method. And I'm going to show you how that's the case over the next 5 or 6 slides. So when we're undertaking a qualitative drug metabolism study, what do we already know? So the first thing we know is structure. And knowing structure allows us to infer likely biotransformation. So here's nifazidone. I've got a chlorine in it. So A, I've got a halogen isotope pattern, which you can see at bottom left. But I also know that I might get oxidative dechlorination, for example, or I may have internal cleavage of the piperazine ring. So knowing the structure allows me to define some likely target metabolites that I can find. If I do a simple scouting run, though, I can also get the retention time, and I know that, you know, most metabolites are going to elute ahead of parent, so maybe I want to look in those regions. But more importantly, I get a product ion spectrum. And that's a product ion spectrum which is representative. It defines the parent compound. It's characteristic of the parent compound. And so I can use that product ion spectrum to good advantage, and I can derive neutral losses. And finally, if I have an immobility enabled mass spectrometer, I can also measure the collisional cross section. And so there's the driftogram at bottom right, and I can use that too. So if I take that data and I analyze it in Unified, that allows me to develop a method which uses those precursor pieces of information. And on the top, this is how the workflow would run. I have the chromatogram, top left. I've got a drift time resolved precursor ion spectrum on the top, and I've got a drift time resolved product ion spectrum on the bottom. And product ions, which have got the small blue callouts on them, have been automatically assigned a structure by the software. So now I've got product ions for the parent compound. I can push those to the scientific library. And having pushed them to the scientific library, I can then pull them into the method and do two things. So the first is I can define a list of product ions which I'm going to look for in any detected components, but I can also derive the neutral losses for each of those product ions and put those into a neutral loss table. And both of those are going to help me find drug-related material. So when I process the data using the method we've just created, I get this table, and you can see the added value of having that information in there. So the first thing is, normally we're going to get master charge and you're going to see retention time, but on Vian and on Synapt, processed with Unify, you get an extra column. And that column is the collisional cross-section. It's there by default, the calibration's done up front, and that extra parameter that we can use to our advantage is up front and center, just as a natural part of any analysis that you have. Then we have a series of columns, which I've called out in green. And those are telling us something about the properties of each component. So in the first column, the software is telling me, are there any other plausible explanations for this mass change? Is that mass to charge inside the allowed mass defect space for the compound? Does the spectrum of the precursor have a halogen isotope pattern? Does it have any product ions in common with the parent? And does it have any constant neutral losses in common with the parent? So that again is allowing me to filter down to the drug-related material. Bottom left, you can see the extracted ion chromatogram for nifazidone hydroxylations, and called out in blue is the specific component that I'm looking at. On the right-hand side, by that chromatogram, are the low-energy spectrum and the high-energy spectrum for that component, and these are drift time resolved. So in the top is the is the nifazidone hydroxylation with a mass of 486.226 and a drift time of 2.51 milliseconds. And at the bottom are the high-energy ions, which are coming from the precursor, which has a mass of 486.226 and a drift time of 2.51 milliseconds. And that cleanup's really important for getting the best outcomes. So having got a set of components, the next question we ask is, which of these are actually drug-related? Which are false positives? Which are true metabolites? And so we have the drug-related properties columns, halogen isotope patterns, mass defect matches, alternative assignments, and so on. But a very useful way of distinguishing drug-related material is to look at the time-relatedness of response. So in this sample, it's a cross-species comparison. So I've got human, rat, dog, and monkey incubations done at four different time points, plus the T0 control. And you can see for this metabolite, I have a temporal response and a species dependency. So that says to me, yes, this is very likely to be a real metabolite. Here's another component, not in the table, but just one I've randomly selected. And you can see the chromatogram. But now you can see in the trend plot, there's no time dependency and no species dependency for this component. So that suggests it's a false positive and it's actually not real at all. I talked about the value of HDMSE for generating clean product ion spectra. So here's nifazidone itself with the product ion spectrum of nifazidone. You can see at top, this is a four-dimensional componentization. So I've taken the peak at 470, the mass at 470, at the retention time of 3.13 minutes with a drift time of 4 milliseconds plus or minus a small tolerance. And that's cleaned up the spectrum of nifazidone into what you see there. And the beauty of HDMSE is this is a generic approach. So in this sample, there are around 25 to 30 metabolites. And by doing that drift time resolution, I can generate a clean product ion spectrum for every one of those with no preconditions, no data-directed acquisition. This is all in post-processing. So I have a clean product ion spectrum for every metabolite, irrespective of the nature of that component. In fact, I have a clean product ion spectrum for every component in this sample, all 600 or 700 of them. So that's about how we can use HGMSE to clean up data and how we can use it to inform our choices about which components we're going to identify as real. What about thinking in multiple dimensions? How we can use the CCS axis to understand our data better? So here's one way. I'm taking that same data set and I can visualize the data in one two-dimensional way, and that's a plot of CCS on the y-axis in this plot versus retention time on the x-axis. And inside that plot, I know that there's some formulation co-eluting, some polyethylene glycol that's there, so I can create a polygon around that space in retention time CCS space and isolate just the components which lie in that region. And then I can change dimension. So I was looking, if you like, in this dimension. Now I can actually pivot to look in a different way. And so I've switched now for those same selected components into drift time mass to charge space. So now I can create another polygon around where I know that the singly charged PEG ions elute in that orthogonal view and create a second polygon around that. So what I've effectively done is created a three-dimensional volume inside my retention time CCS master charge space, which is specific for polyethylene glycol. And if I look at that now, you can see here's the chromatogram in the top of all the PEG components and the spectrum of all the PEG components. And on the bottom, the driftogram, the CCS display of the various components in there too. And having done that, I can create a formulation filter. So this is something that's gonna lie inside my processing method. And I can say if a detected component lies inside that volume, flag it as potentially belonging to matrix. So one that I perhaps don't have to consider. And I could create a comparable filter which selects positively for small molecule mass to charge retention time CCS space or small molecule CCS retention time space as well. And I can include that filter in my data processing. So here's how that would bubble through into the analysis. On this plot, I'm showing an analysis of one of those samples, and on the left-hand side is just all the components that are present in that sample. And there are around 650 individual components in that first sample. I can say, remove everything that's not in allowed mass-to-charge CCS space for small molecules. And that takes about 40% of those components are unlikely to be drugs or drug metabolites because they're not in the allowed space. I can then say, if it's in that space, but it's also in the control, remove it. So now I want analyte-specific components which are in allowed mass CCS space. And then I can impose a mass defect filter. And then finally, I can say, show me those, but then highlight the ones that have got either a common fragment ion or a common neutral loss, or they have a halogen isotope pattern, or they've been assigned a plausible biotransformation by the software. So if any one of those four properties are true, keep it. And so I've gone then from 650 potential components in essentially the unsupervised analysis down to a very manageable 50 or so. And if I look through those 50, I can identify around 30 which are true confirmed metabolites, and that's left me with 20 or so that I need to remove. So I've turned something which is going to be a real challenge to walk through into something which is very doable. So one of the challenges we have with drug metabolism often is isobaric metabolites, metabolites with the same mass. And I've chosen three of those from this nifazodone sample to show on this plot. On the x-axis is retention time, and on the y-axis is mass to charge. And they're isobaric, so they've got the same mass to charge. They're different intensities, so we've got different isotope patterns for those because of the relative intensities. And on the right-hand side, you can see the extracted ion chromatogram for that mass, the spectral area that we're looking at, and the driftogram in that master charge space as well. And if I switch in now into looking at retention, if I switch now and look at CCS on the y-axis and retention time on the x-axis, now those isobaric metabolites have got different sizes and shapes, and so they have a different CCS value. A little bit noisy at the moment, and that's because I'm selecting a rather large spectral window, mass spectral window, to generate this view. But if I just focus on the C12 isotope peak and zoom in on that one into this view, now a lot of that background disappears because the intensity is coming from background signals in that same. I'm taking actually a box down through the plot when I look this, so that's giving me more selectivity. And when I analyze the measure the CCS value by looking at the peak areas and that the software is doing an automatic analysis of the volume of the peak, I get different CCS values even though they're isobaric. Here's a plot of five isobaric nifazidone oxidations in that sample. There are seven nifazidone double oxidations and then two ketones in that sample. And with 20 samples in this set, I can measure the average CCS value and the standard deviation of the CCS value across those samples for each independent metabolite that I have. And what's really remarkable here is that although we think about CCS values as being accurate to around 1% between instruments and over time, if we do a within-sample analysis over a couple of hours of acquisition here, the stability of the instrument and the tightness of the CCS values is much, much narrower than that. And in fact, in this sample, the between sample variation for each individual component is less than 0.1% RSD for the CCS. And so you can clearly see, for example, M11 on that trace there has a significantly higher CCS value than M14, for example, or any of the others. And the same is true with the double oxidations. I've got M8, which has got a smaller CCS value than the others. And I can use that then in modeling inputs. I can see whether I can model those various possibilities and determine where is the match between the experimental value of the CCS and the modeled CCS value. And in extreme situations, so here's the in the inset panel for the ketones, I've got two oxidations there, which are different in CCS value by almost 7 square angstroms, and almost certainly they are changing the shape of the central piperazine ring in nifazidone. So this is a common way that you might look at a cross-species comparison. We have a set of chromatograms, so it's a two-dimensional representation, if you will, intensity versus retention time, and we've labeled them with the metabolites that we've identified. And if we want to try and understand the differences between the compositions and over time, then this is a commonly used representation. But can we do any better than that? Well, with the benefit of CCS, we can do some quite clever things. So here's a trellis plot of that same cross-species comparison at one time point. So on the x-axis in this plot, I've got master charge. On the y-axis, I've got the measured CCS value. And the size of the bubble denotes the response of the of that particular component. And you can see up at top right in each of these where I've got my double hydroxylations, I've got multiple entities, multiple double hydroxylations, which are discriminated on the basis of their CCS value. And similarly, here you can see those ketone metabolites of nifazidone having very, very different CCS values. So that's one way of looking at it. Can I go even further than that? Well, here's the same cross-species comparison here, but trellised in two dimensions now. So I'm trellising in X by species, but I'm trellising in Y by incubation time. So in this plot, I can do things like this. The red circle at top right in each panel is the parent, and you can see that disappearing as I go down the trace. So that's the disappearance of parent. But I can also track appearance of metabolites as well. Now, this you might argue this is overkill, but I think I put it in there just to stimulate thinking about how we can represent these kind of complex multidimensional data sets in a way which is maybe going to be more impactful than the old ways we've used with chromatograms and simple line plots over time. So here are the conclusions that I'd take away from the work that we've done here. So the first is HTMSE has a huge amount of value for doing qualitative investigations. It's a generic approach, very broadly applicable. It's unsupervised, so it's unprejudiced. Capture all the data and then figure out what's present. In HDMSC, we have a CCS-resolved product ion spectrum for every component in the sample, and most importantly, the drug metabolites that we're looking for. We have three dimensions of discrimination, so not just time and mass, which we've always have had, but we also have CCS. And remember, in those tables, CCS is right there in front of you from the very beginning. No extra work done to pull those out. Historically, switching on ion mobility in spectrometers has led to some compromises. So, for example, in linear dynamic range and sensitivity. But on Vion, those are addressed. So those improvements in hardware have given us an extra order of magnitude of linear dynamic range, which we can make very good use of. The workflows that I showed you, taking advantage of everything that we know about the compound, that structure, that's product ion spectrum, retention time, CCS, for example, allow us to drill down to those components which are going to be the ones that we're really looking for. CCS values by themselves have intrinsic value, which we can use in modeling, and I think it's really going to be interesting to see how we use CCS values to good effect over the coming years. I'm not speaking about it here, but there's another presentation coming up on the Waters website from Mark Rohner, also who spoke at ASMS about using TOF's CCS selectivity and high resolution to drive quantitation. And as I've already said, modeling CCS is going to be something which is going to be an important part of the toolkit that we have. This talk wouldn't have been possible without the help from a lot of colleagues at Waters and external collaborators. So I'll acknowledge all of the people on this slide and a number of others who are too numerous to mention, and Kevin Bateman from Merck for his provision.